In the last 20 years, Dr. Jeff Myers has become one of America's most respected authorities on youth leadership development. And he has just been named the president of Summit Ministries. You heard about that last night. You'll be hearing more about that this morning. In addition to his work on Understanding the Times and Lightbearers courses for Christian schools, Dr. Myers has many books and video courses, including Of Knights and Fair Maidens, Playpen to Podium, Secrets of Great Communicators, Secrets of the World Changers, Secrets of Everyday Leaders. Is it me, or does this man have a lot of secrets? We'll find out. Handoff, and most recently, Cultivate, Forming the Emerging Generation Through Life-on-Life Mentoring. He comes now to help us understand the ideas that are ruling the world. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. David Myers.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you, brother.
Go get him, man.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. I'm so grateful to Pastor Jack as a guy who will say, this church will take a stand for truth, and we will have meetings like this right here. And I'm also grateful to Gina Gleason. Gina is a warrior, and she's part of your congregation here putting this together. She's done a tremendous job. Well, as you can probably tell from the way I'm dressed, I'm from Manitou Springs, Colorado. The New York Times travel reviewer called Manitou Springs a hippie Mayberry. And that's probably the most accurate description I could give you. My front porch is very close to the sidewalk, and people are walking by all of the time. The other night, a guy walked by, and he was shaking a stick and shouting, love, peace, happiness. And I was just staring at him. He looked over at me, and he said, I just made a new wand, and I'm casting happy spells. I'm guessing this doesn't happen in your neighborhood. But it's a very different place from the place in which I grew up. I'll tell you about that in just a moment. But I do want to tell you, I thought it was hilarious last night when Frank talked about how fast he talks. I talk fast as well, but I've got a simple way for you to get the notes here. All you need to do is, if you've got a smartphone with you, you don't have to turn it off. You can turn it on and send a text to 95577 and just text the word notes. Okay, 95577, and that way you won't have to try to write down everything that's on the screen. And some of you are like, I wasn't going to write it down anyway. Got it all right here. Steel trap, baby. Yeah, just make sure it doesn't get rusted. In case it is rusted, you can just send for the note, so you can text to that. Well, when I was a little boy, and this is me as a little boy, my parents put me in a suit and made me look a lot more innocent than I really was. I actually grew up in a very bad town in Detroit, Michigan in 1967 when I was a tiny baby. There was a riot. 69 people died. More than 1,000 went to the hospital and 2,000 buildings were destroyed. My parents were very defensive about all of this, trying to protect my little brother and me. But you can only protect kids so much. They told me later, look, by the time you were 4, you had a vocabulary that could make a sailor blush. At 7 years of age, I was offered hard drugs for the first time. I remember the police and the ambulance taking the body out of the house across the street after the man had died from a heroin overdose. And my parents said, we have to get our kids out of this environment, so let's go back to our roots. My folks are from Kansas and Oklahoma, so we moved to Great Bend, Kansas. That, my friends, is culture shock. From a town of 1.8 million people to a town of 20,000 people, from a church of 2,000 people to a church of 20 people. There was no youth program in this church. On Wednesday night, they said to us, look, you boys, just go ahead and play outside while we have our prayer meeting. So we did. I don't remember if it was the first week or the second week there, but we found some Dixie cups and masking tape and gasoline, and we made a bomb. We set it on fire, and of course the parking lot was then on fire. We put it out as quickly as we could. We didn't think anybody noticed, but the next week there was a youth program. There were three boys in it, my brother and me, and then the son of the police chief, who was just as ornery as the two of us. And our orneriness was expressed in this class by asking all kinds of questions. The teacher would say, open your Bibles to the book of John. We're going to look at the life of Jesus. And my hand would go up and say, Jesus talked about hell, but don't you think that's overkill? I mean, people aren't really that bad, are they, that they would deserve eternal punishment? And the teacher would be like, that's what we went for every week, all right? But I had a lot of questions. And finally, the people in the church there and my parents arranged for me to go to Manitou Springs, Colorado, to study for 2 weeks with Dr. David Noble, the founder of an organization called Summit Ministries. I walked into that facility. I was just graduated from high school. I met Dr. David Noble, and I said, I hope you have a lot of answers because I have a lot of questions. Can you imagine a more rude thing to say as an opening sentence to a person? But I was desperate. I wanted to understand the times in which I lived, and I didn't feel that Christianity was giving very good answers. And so Dr. David Noble said to me, we're not afraid of any question here at the Summit. He said, but let me ask you a question first. What do you have in your life that's so worth living for, you'd be willing to die for it? And I realized, not that I had an answer to the question, but I realized for the first time in my life, I didn't even know anybody thought like that. I mean, the truth is, everybody I knew, we believe in God, but they lived as if he didn't exist. They went about their business. If anything, church was just an escape from the rest of life for them. The idea that God would be behind everything, that justice was real, that love is real, that the incarnation is real, these things had never occurred to me. And that experience changed my life, which is why when Gil talked about the fact that I've recently had the opportunity to take the place of my mentor, Dr. David Noble, as the president of Summit Ministries, I can tell you this is the most joyous thing in my life, because now every year I have the opportunity to work with 50,000 young people in preparing them to become culture-shaping leaders. And aren't we desperate for those kinds of leaders in the time in which we live? So this morning, we have a hard job in front of us. We need to understand the lay of the land. If you're getting ready to go into battle, then you need to understand who the enemy is and what it's about and how all of this is going to work. We can't engage a culture we don't understand. So here's my underlying premise. It's a battle. It's a battle. And it's not a battle of people. It is a battle of ideas. Dr. David Noble and I, David Noble's classic text, Understanding the Times, has been such a blessing in the lives of hundreds of thousands of people. And yeah, I recently had the opportunity to go through the book and rewrite the entire book, sentence by sentence, in a new structure with new information, but the same basic ideas. This book, Understanding the Times, I believe is so critical. It should be on the shelf of every Christian family in the United States of America. In a little bit, I'll tell you why I say that. But the underlying verse behind the title, Understanding the Times, is an Old Testament list of the troop strength of King David. And one tribe is not listed by the number of people they bring to the battlefield, it's listed by the number of leaders they have. The tribe of Issachar, men who had what? Understanding of the times, to do what Israel ought to do, 200 chiefs and all their kinsmen under their command. The New Testament also talks about this, 2 Corinthians 10:5. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to the obedience of Christ. A guy came to me one time and he said, you know, I have a problem with you. I said, why? He said, you're using all of this battle language. I said, what's the problem? He said, well, look at that verse right there. Demolish, take captive. That's all battle language. I said, and so what's the problem? He said, you're making it sound like life is a conflict. He said, I'm a pacifist. I'm opposed to that. I have a problem with you. He was so angry, I thought he was going to hit me. But then I realized that would contradict everything he was saying. But he said, that's a problem with you. And I said, sir, I got some news for you. I said, I respect you. You're my elder. I get all of that. But sir, you don't have a problem with me. Because everything I just put on the screen is right here. Your problem is with God. We are in a battle. And people say, well, aren't you tired of the culture war language? And I said, now that is a fair point. Let me explain how the battle works from a biblical viewpoint. We have to understand who the enemy actually is. And some people are like, the enemy? That's some liberals in Sacramento. The enemy? That's some hippies in San Francisco. It's those environmental wackos trying to take over the Central Valley, right? I mean, we look at the other people, we say, people are the enemy. Here's the biblical viewpoint. Those people aren't the enemy. Not a single one of them. The enemy is Satan, and he has taken them captive to do his will. And so the goal in a spiritual battle is not that we try to end the heartbeat of people who stand opposed to us, but that we try to remove the barriers that hold them captive so their hearts can come to Jesus. This is a completely different understanding of what actually is going on in the culture and how we are to wage battle. But that's the big question, isn't it? How do we wage battle? The truth is, and I'm sorry to tell you this first thing on a Saturday morning, because I know there are a lot of other things you could have been doing. We're not fighting as Christians a one-front battle. Satan is battling against us on 5 different fronts. So we need to understand each one of those fronts, and then we need to thoroughly understand the spiritual weapons we bring into the battle. And that is my goal, by the time we finish this morning, to have talked about those 5 different fronts, to talk about what it means to have a Christian worldview, and then give some ideas about the difference it makes to have a Christian worldview. My goal is this: you'll never turn on the television again and watch the news in the same way. You'll never read a newspaper again in the same way. You'll understand exactly what is going on in Sacramento and exactly why the people who are proposing the bills they propose are doing it. And you'll start to grasp and understand how to respond intelligently from a Christian worldview that actually engages the culture in a way that brings human flourishing and gives people the opportunity to come to Jesus. Does that make sense? Is that fair enough? Woo, that's a lot to do. Are you ready to work? All right, let's get to work. First, we need to understand a key term. Just write this down in your notes. The term is worldview. You see, when you put on a pair of glasses, it brings the world into focus. So a worldview is your view of the world and your view for the world. A worldview is a pattern of ideas, of beliefs, of convictions and habits that help us make sense of God, the world, and our relationship to God and the world. The key word inside the definition of worldview is the word pattern, because ideas flow in patterns. If ideas are the enemies, and there are millions of them out there, how could we ever identify them? The answer to the question, I think, was answered for me when I began to understand for the first time how to return a serve from tennis professional Andy Roddick. Now, trust me, I have never actually returned one of his serves. But Andy Roddick is known among tennis professionals for having the fastest serve of anybody who's played professional tennis. Get this, Andy Roddick can serve the tennis ball at 156 miles an hour. And you're like, I want body armor. I'm not kidding. Yeah, you would not stand against him without ceramic plates guarding you. Because this is serious, 156 miles an hour. And physiologists say to us, at 156 miles an hour in that short of space, it is physiologically impossible for the human body to respond in time to return a serve like that. It is impossible to do it. And yet, professional tennis players returned his serves all the time. How did they do it? I asked one of my buddies who had been a professional tennis player, did you ever play Andy Roddick? Oh, yes. I said, what was his serve like? And he emailed back, absolutely enormous. And then I asked him, did you ever return the serve? Yes, I did. How did you do it? He told me a fascinating story. He said, when you play tennis enough, you start to understand there are little clues, there are patterns that other players put off. And the little patterns could be everything from where he looks on the court to how he holds his racket to his position on the court to the way he tosses the ball to what he has done in past games and similar situations. All of those things reveal patterns that give you an understanding of where the ball is going to go and how to return the serve. That's fascinating. So you can actually do something that's impossible if you can understand the patterns. And then I looked at the example of chess. Grandmaster chess players were always thought to have a photographic memory because they could look at a chessboard of a partially played chess game for 2 seconds, turn around, and on a piece of paper record the position on the board of every single piece. They must have a photographic memory. So the researchers decided to trick them. This is so cruel to have done this. They said, all right, we've established that you're pretty accurate in putting those pieces on the board. We want you to turn around one more time and look at this board. And then they didn't put the pieces of the partially played chess game. They randomly arranged the pieces in a way they would never appear in an actual game. The players turned around, 1001, 1002. Then they turned around to write them on the piece of paper, and their level of recall was not significantly better than the non-chess players who had looked at the same board as a control group. In other words, they didn't photographically memorize the board. They were looking for patterns of play. And because they understood the patterns, things would very quickly come into place for them, and they would know how to respond. The patterns of ideas can be known in response to the answer, in response to 5 different questions. And again, these will be texted to you if you send a text to me, but you can see these on the screen here. Origin, identity, meaning, morality, and destiny. Where did we come from? That's a question of origin, identity. Who are we anyway? When we say we, are we humans really any different than any other creature? I mean, if the spiritual world does not exist, that only the physical world exists, then what's really the difference between us and, say, chickens or some little fish that floats in a river in the Central Valley or whatever? I mean, why would we prefer human beings over anybody else? Meaning, how do we make sense of the world? Morality, how should we live our lives? And destiny, what will become of us? All right, here's the key news. Please look up here for a second. Everybody in the world answers these 5 questions. Everybody. There's nobody who doesn't have a worldview. Everybody answers these 5 questions. And their answers to these 5 questions will determine how they vote. It will determine how they parent. It will determine what kind of a neighbor they are. It will determine their spiritual beliefs and everything else. Actually, I had a kid on a campus say to me one time, I don't answer those 5 questions, so I guess I don't have a worldview. I said, well, can I ask them of you? He said, okay, where did you come from? Random chance processes, identity, or who are we as human beings? He said, nothing, no, nothing special. How do we make sense of the world? The world makes no sense. How should we live? Doesn't matter. What will become of us? Nothing. We came from nothing, we go to nothing. I said, guess what? You have a worldview. You just answered all 5 questions. He said, I do? I said, yeah. Your worldview is called nihilism. Nihilism means a belief in nothing, but a belief in nothing is surely a belief in something. Because the average human being makes 10,000 decisions a day, and every one of those decisions, even subtly, is affected by our worldview. Does this make sense so far? All right, so if we understand that everybody has to answer those 5 questions, then we can begin to look at some of the worldviews out there in the world around us. Here's the secret that all Christians should know. I wish every Christian in the world would know this. All of the other worldviews outside of Christianity are all counterfeits. They're all counterfeits. They're all attempts to mimic what Christianity brings. And by the way, Frank Turek's new book, Stealing from God, goes through this in detail, and you'll get a really good sense of how this works. But they're counterfeits. And a counterfeit is an imitation of a thing that intends to defraud by passing itself off as the original. So every other worldview, to the degree that it has any meaning at all, is because it's stolen it from Christianity. Some time ago, I was in Seoul, Korea. I was walking down the street in a shopping district called Itaewon, and a guy walked up to me and said, hey, would you like a real fake Rolex? And I didn't know what to say. I wanted to say to him, are you sure it's a real fake? Because everybody else on this street has fake fakes. Here's a weird thought. A real fake is actually more fake than a fake fake. Because it's more likely to trick people. So there are 5 fake worldviews. Each one of these worldviews forms a front in the battle of ideas. When students come to one of our summit courses for 12 days, 16 to 21 years of age, and by the way, don't ever sell these kids short in the potential they have. The world says, oh, they only have a 90-second attention span. The very first night they're at Summit, I give a talk like this, and it's 90 minutes long, and they're sitting on the edge of their seats and taking notes the whole time. And they're like, you just disproved everything your culture says about you. You have the potential to be a rising generation of leaders, and don't let anybody talk you out of it. So these are the different worldviews we're going to face. The first worldview, the first front, the first counterfeit idea is the worldview of secularism. And just for the sake of simplicity, I mean, in the book Understanding the Times, we go into detail about the secular worldview. This book right here, this was a labor of love. 3,000 hours of work, 550 different sources, 1,600 footnotes, and the conclusion it draws at the very end is really simple. No other worldview even comes close to the Christian worldview in explaining reality and what is meaningful in the world to us. So I love that. I think it's very, very encouraging. But this is the first worldview. This is probably the dominant worldview among state officials in the state of California. Is it okay to just be honest about this? All right. This is the dominant worldview. They believe the problem is God belief. Their belief is this. The more we get God out of everything else, the better the world will be. Let's get God out of it. Now, the biblical position, and I think the church's position for centuries has always been, the church is the institution God has established to help the state be the state, to help the state do what is just and to love what is right. But this viewpoint is get Christians out of it as much as possible. And how do you get them out of it? You shame them. You say nasty things about them. You try to trick them. You try to mask the underlying ideas so that they don't understand what you're actually trying to do. All of those kinds of things. You see, the secular worldview is that God is kind of like a myth. I mean, kind of like Santa Claus. And in fact, I was at a conference one time and a lady came to me. She said, you said about God that God is always present with us. She said, I would never teach that to my children. I said, why not? She said, because it's creepy. And I realized what she was saying. She believes God is like Santa Claus. And if he is, that is creepy. I mean, let's be honest. Santa Claus is watching you. Oh, I'm fixing to ruin a perfectly good song for you. You better watch out. You better not cry. You better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. Santa Claus is a stalker. The secular worldview says Santa Claus is just a representation of God. God is a stalker. We want to get God out of all considerations. Now, for most secularists, it never occurs to them that their understanding of God is really truncated because they have a counterfeit worldview, but they don't realize it's a counterfeit. They've never taken time to understand the unbelievable picture we get of who God actually is in Scripture. But this is true, you know. So if your reaction to Santa Claus growing up was like this, that's totally rational, I just have to tell you. That's the secular worldview. The second major front in the world of ideas is Marxism. Now, a lot of people say, why do you talk about Marxism? Because isn't communism dead? And this is interesting, because I spend most of my time on university campuses. I assure you, Marxism is alive and well on university campuses in the United States of America right now. If you have a kid at college, there is a 100% chance he will be influenced by Marxist professors while he is there. And if you just look around the world, while there are now five or six countries that used to be under the communist banner in Europe that aren't under the communist banner anymore, if you actually move out from Europe to the rest of the world, you realize that 20% of the people in the world right now live in a communist regime. One out of five people in the world. And if you look at the number of people in the world who live in countries that are influenced significantly by Marxist thinking because the Marxist Party has a dominant influence in those countries, it's two-thirds of the world's population. So somebody who says Marxism is dead, we don't need to think about that anymore, probably is trying to trick you into thinking this worldview isn't your enemy. Just be aware of it. So the Marxist worldview says the problem is the rich. We need to increase taxes. We need to take away private property. We need to have regulations that diminish what people can do with the resources God has given to them, because in the process of doing that, we can move people along the path of socialism to this ultimate utopia we call communism. Karl Marx said in the Communist Manifesto, the communists openly declare that their ends can be attained only by what? The forcible overthrow of all existing social conditions. There's a guy running for the Democratic nomination for the presidency of the United States right now who says openly, I am a socialist and a revolutionary. And he recently had 10,000 people in his audience in Madison, Wisconsin, the largest audience of people who've come to hear any of the presidential candidates so far. So don't think this worldview is not out there anymore, Karl Marx. So what is it about? It's all about economics, okay? To the Marxist, you scratch any conflict and it bleeds economics. Friedrich Engels, the co-author of Karl Marx, said, in every historical epoch, the prevailing mode of economic production forms the basis upon which is built up the political and intellectual history of that epoch. It's actually hard for me to hear that, not because it's not what a Marxist believed, but just because I'm just looking at his beard. I'm like, dude, what is it with these guys and their beards? That one is a stunning beard, I have to admit. I'm looking at him, and I'm kind of ADHD, or I'm actually ADOS. You know what that means? Attention deficit. Oh, shiny. He's talking about economics and all this serious stuff, and I'm just looking at him going, how do you eat? But... But that is a serious worldview. If somebody says it's all about economics, it's all about the gap between the rich and the poor, it's not necessarily that that person cares about the poor. It's that they are trying to propose a worldview to overthrow capitalism, overthrow the family, and overthrow the church to try to arrive at a communist society. Does that mean that everybody who says we ought to increase taxes is a communist? No, it doesn't mean that. It just means we need to be aware these ideas are influencing people, even sometimes people who don't think they are being influenced. Third worldview. You thought we were politically incorrect so far. Islam. Now, in the book Understanding the Times, David Noble and I reveal the thing about Islam that almost nobody in the world understands. And then we show how to respond intelligently to this worldview. But I'm going to tell you right now what it is. To Islam, everybody in the world who has ever been born was born a Muslim. And if you are not a Muslim now, it is because you are in rebellion against Allah. The process of disciplining people to obey Allah and cease their rebellion against Him is called jihad. Every Muslim in the world believes in jihad. It is in the Quran. You cannot believe the Quran without believing in jihad. The question is whether or not you weaponize that belief, like the people in the group ISIS do. The second question, and this is probably where it gets to be politically incorrect, and just be aware of it. The second question is, what will everybody else do? What leaders will they follow? If the people who weaponize Islam win the battle for the hearts of Muslims around the world, will everybody else, all the other Muslims, fall in line? Or will there be a peaceful course for Islam? This is a critical distinction we face at the present time, and we should be on our knees praying for our Muslim neighbors that they will come to an understanding of the truth. And we should be praying for our leaders and seeking to have an influence so that Because we have there are two paths. And right now, I'll be really honest with you, the world could go either direction. And the last time the world faced this crisis was about 500 years ago. And let me just give you a hint from history. It was almost the end of Western civilization. Okay? And it's here upon us again. So this worldview is also a front. We need to take it very seriously. The fourth worldview, and this is the worldview of the town where I live, Manitou Springs, Colorado, new spirituality. And the problem, see, everybody says there's a problem, and everybody proposes a solution. Have you noticed that about each one of these worldviews? They all think they know what the problem is. The problem to new spirituality is that we don't realize we're God. And we are God, the new spiritualist says. Everybody in the world is God. Everything is all one thing. When you start with an understanding of God, God is a force, right? I teach my students sometimes, I'll say, do you remember in Star Wars where Obi-Wan Kenobi said to Luke Skywalker, Luke, the force loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. And they're like, no, I don't remember that. No, neither do I. It wasn't there. A force is something you use. A person is someone you love. How you start with your understanding of God will affect everything else you believe about the world. That's new spirituality. All right, now I'm going to throw you for a ringer. There's a fifth front. In addition to these other four worldviews, in addition to secularism, in addition to Marxism, in addition to Islam, in addition to new spirituality, the fifth front, and this is one our students are facing on university campuses every day, is postmodernism. Postmodernism says, after modernism, science and religion didn't solve our problems. See, so we're now postmodern. We're after that. And the postmodernist says, our problem is our obsession with truth. What we need to do is give up the idea that there is any kind of truth. I'm so glad Frank went through this with you last night to talk about how you respond to people like this. And I was chuckling as I was listening to it because this was the popular philosophy when I went to the university, a bachelor's degree, a master's degree, and a doctoral degree, and postmodernism was the constant theme all throughout all of them. We were studying people like this, Martin Heidegger, the German philosopher, who would say things like this, in the naming, the things named are called into their thinging. Thinging they unfold world in which things abide and so are abiding ones. By thinging, things carry out world. And all God's people said, huh? Is he saying the world doesn't exist? No, he's not. Actually, he's saying that the world doesn't exist. What he's saying is, like, this lectern, before you came into this room, if you had never been in here before, you had never seen it. Therefore, for you, it did not exist until you saw it and thought, ah, I bet that's the lectern. I bet that's where the speakers put all of their things. Then you incorporated it into your existence, and for you, it came into existence. All right? In other words, you are the center of reality. Trust me, this changes the way teachers teach classes. And in a way that was a lot of fun for me as a student, because I would go into an English literature class, and the professor would say, I would ask, well, what's the author trying to say? And he would say, it doesn't matter what the author's trying to say, what does it mean to you? It occurred to me, I can make up whatever I want. Oh, that was so much fun. And I had a philosopher professor friend who was feeding me information all the time, so it was great. So we read Moby Dick. Oh, professor, what's the author trying to say? It doesn't matter what the author's trying to say. What does it mean to you? And I would say things like, well, you see, professor, Moby Dick is the Republic of Ireland. And Captain Ahab represents the British state trying to subdue this unruly province to its own ruin. And the professor was like, oh, that's brilliant. And I would be thinking, no, it's stupid. I'm just saying things. It just kept going on in class, and finally I was just fed up with it. So the professor said to us one day, I want you to write a poem and bring it back to class. So I went up to him after and said, professor, thank you for the invitation to write a poem. I'm not going to do it. He said, why not? I said, because I don't want to. It's not true for me. He said, well, it's a graded assignment. I said, no, professor, don't tell me that. I said, I seriously do not think you will grade me down because I don't write a poem. He said, why do you think I won't grade you down? I said, professor, if you grade me down for not writing a poem, what you are saying in essence is that what you believe and what you value is more important than what I believe and what I value. And because you're in a position of authority, you intend to punish me for not conforming to what you believe and value. And that, professor, would be an act of gross intolerance. And I do not see you as an intolerant man. I waited like three heartbeats and he chuckled. He said, that's pretty funny. I said, thank you. I was hoping that would be your reaction. I didn't want to flunk, I just had to bring it up. He said, okay, will you write the poem for the sake of class discussion? Sure, okay, for the sake of class discussion, I will write it. But all the way back to my room, I was fuming. I couldn't think of what to do. Finally, I got the idea. I got back to my room. I reached into the closet and I pulled out a typewriter, which is a mechanical instrument into which you insert a piece of paper. And I typed the title of my poem, Destruction. The poem itself was one word. It was the word destruction, except I pulled the paper out of the typewriter so that the letters fell off toward the bottom of the page, right? That the word itself was being destroyed, which was my point. So I took it to class, and in my roommate's encouragement, before I turned it in, I crumbled it up. He said, is that trash? I said, no, that's not trash. That's my poem. He unfolded it. He said, this is brilliant. I love how the crinkled paper embodies the concept of destruction. Inside, I was thinking, I did not say aloud, but inside, I was thinking, you like that, prof? I can crank those babies out every 15 seconds. I was being schooled, but I was not being educated, you see, and there is a profound difference between those two things. When a world begins to accept postmodernism as its worldview, then you are in a great deal of difficulty, and you need to go back and look at the kinds of things Frank talked about last night. Those are the solutions to it. All right, well, let me give you the good news. The biblical Christian worldview stands head and shoulders above all these other worldviews. Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father but through me. You know, when I first read this as a new believer, I had already studied philosophy. And I looked at that and I thought, the way, the truth, and the life, I've seen that before. And sure enough, you know, the ancient philosophers asked three questions. What is good, what is true, and what is beautiful? And it's the same questions. And Jesus says, I am. I am. He's not just saying, I am this and I am that, and I guess I'm a third thing too. It's not that. He is saying, I am the answer to the philosopher's quest. When Jesus said, I am the way, well, that's a very common term to the people who grew up in a Hebrew tradition. They all understood the idea of the way. There's a way of life, there's a way of death. You see, all that idea of the way means a moral course of action. This is fascinating. We recently, about 3 years ago, found a new friend, an atheist philosopher named Luc Ferry, who's a French philosopher and very well respected. He wrote a book called A Brief History of Time. And Brief History of Time. And then he said this in the book. This is the first chapter he's really getting into where the world of ideas came from. He said, it is to Christianity that Western civilization owed its entire democratic inheritance. Not to these other worldviews, not to secularism, science. Rodney Stark is a sociologist, very well known, very prominent publisher. He said there are 52 people who are responsible for the rise of modern science today. And then he asked, guess how many are atheists? One out of the 52 people who are responsible for the rise of modern science. You say, well, I did never hear that before. It's because other worldviews are feeding you their ideas. All right. Second, Jesus said, I am the truth. The idea of the truth is the source of what can be known. Can we actually know anything at all? C.S. Lewis had an interesting argument about this in a radio address he gave during World War II, and I quote it in Understanding the Times. He said, suppose there were no intelligence behind the universe. In that case, nobody designed my brain for the purpose of thinking. Thought is merely the byproduct of some atoms within my skull. But if so, how can I trust my own thinking to be true? But if I can't trust my own thinking, of course, I can't trust the arguments leading to atheism and therefore have no reason to be an atheist or anything else. Unless I believe in God, I can't believe in thought, so I can never use thought to disbelieve in God. That guy's smart. He should write a book. If I were him, I'd call it Mere Christianity. And I would try to get everybody to read it. Yeah. Jesus said, I am the truth. But then Jesus said, I am the life, the key to a meaningful life. Do you realize how these other worldviews, more than anything else, are obsessed with death? You know why they're obsessed with death? Because that's where they lead. People look at the Marxist worldview and they don't ever really contemplate it. But in the Soviet Union, we don't even know how many millions of people died under communism. We know it's somewhere between 20 and 60 million people died under that worldview. In China, we know it's 40 to 70 million people. And Jesus said in John 10:10, I have come that they might have life and have it to the full. Lewis put it this way, I believe in Christianity as I believe that the sun has risen, not only because I see it, but because by it I see everything else. This applies to areas like economics. You see, in the world of economics, let's say in international aid, for example, if you're a secularist, you believe no God exists, then the only goal of international aid is to keep people alive, give them food, give them vaccinations, keep them alive. Christians, however, operating in international aid have come in the guy in many different organizations, some of which you're familiar with, and they have said, no, it's not just that people have to be kept alive one more day. That's not victory. Victory would be freeing them from the barriers that prevent them from bearing the image of Almighty God. And when we do that, then they can rise up and get an education and start businesses and become the solution to the problems that ail them. One of our Summit Ministries dads has a program, a thing called the Paradigm Project. They provide stoves for people in the third world. Respiratory diseases have dropped by 70% in these households. Deforestation has dropped by 70% because they don't need nearly as much wood to fuel their fires. The people have started businesses in order to make these, and they're made by AIDS orphans in Kenya who are learning a trade. There are people learning to sell these things and actually make a business for themselves. Families are better, healthier, the environment is better, and the investors in the United States of America make a 30% return on their investment selling carbon credits to companies like Google and Apple. That's called plundering the Egyptians. It's a win, 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 win. Does that make sense? What about justice? A lot of people say, well, you know, there are two views of justice. Let them all go or lock them up. Those are the two views. No. From a biblical viewpoint, there are two views of justice. The first view of justice is that every single person born has inherent rights, even if they can't claim them. And guess what? Every single person who is unborn has inherent rights, even if they cannot claim them. Whether you can claim your rights is not what gives them to you. As the Constitution says, our founders said, we put this Constitution together to secure the rights to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness, not grant them. They come from God. The modern view, though, is that justice is the right ordering of society. Sir, if somebody steals your car, you might never get the car back, but the person might go to jail. The state acts as if the crime is against the state. The crime is not against the state. The crime is against you. Bring the people together so that those who have committed the crimes have the responsibility to make it right. Well, we have more people in prison in this country at the cost of $50,000 a year from taxpayer money. Why? Because we have ignored God's idea of justice. There's an organization called Justice Fellowship. It's part of Prison Fellowship, founded by the late Chuck Colson, one of my most admired men of all time. Justice Fellowship says, reform the justice system so communities are safer, victims are respected, and offenders are transformed. Trust me, if you get involved with causes like that, you will leave liberals speechless because they have no way to understand justice that's based on the inherent rights of people because they don't believe in God. All right, I'm going to start to draw this to a close. I'm going to give you a couple of very quick personal strategies you can use. Earlier, I said the enemy is Satan, not the people who are taken captive by his ideas. This is scriptural, 2 Timothy 2:25 and 26, and the Lord's servant must not quarrel. Rather, he should be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Those who oppose him, he must, what? Gently instruct in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. It's a mouthful, but boy, right there is our strategy for engagement. Because if we understand, these people are not the enemy. They're the ones who have been taken captive by the enemy. We have a whole different mission as soldiers of Jesus. Let me give you an illustration of how this works. And I know this is probably sad. This is probably, I don't know. I don't know how you feel about me putting up a huge chart like this at the very end of the talk. But this is the outline of the book Understanding the Times. We say we have Christianity here, and then here are the five competitive worldviews, the five counterfeits: secularism, Marxism, postmodernism, new spirituality, and Islam. Now look at this. We went through and analyzed, in their own words, what these worldviews have to say, making their very best case in theology, philosophy, ethics, biology, psychology, sociology, law, politics, economics, and history. And then we show how the Christian worldview trumps every single one of them in every area. 550 different sources, 1,600 footnotes, it's all documented for you. That's the outline of the book. Let me give you an illustration of how this works. When I went to this, David Noble was working on this years and years ago, I went to the University of Denver. I went there to get my doctoral degree. There's 25 students in the program. They said, only 7 of you will ever graduate. And I said, what do you do with the other 18? Are they buried in the backyard or something? They said, no. They just drop out. But I was determined to be one of the 7. The very first class I took, I went into the class was called Psychology of the Spoken Language. So you look down the side here, well, I'm going to be in the psychology area. I know that because the class is called Psychology of the Spoken Language, right? As we say in Tennessee, this ain't rocket surgery. Okay. I'm glad you got that. My entire career was in Tennessee for 14 years. That was awesome. But then I went to the store to get the textbook, and it was written by a man named L.S. Vygotsky. Vygotsky, Russian. I wonder if they're Marxist. Then I looked inside and realized L.S. Vygotsky had been a student of Ivan Pavlov. Remember the guy who worked with the dogs? Marxist psychologist. So now I know I'm in a Marxist psychology class, my very first class at the doctoral level. So I walked into class. I don't want to challenge the professor. I just want to ask questions. And in just a minute, I'm going to show you what those questions are. I walked into class. Well, by the way, the Marxist view, right, what this little box says right here is mind-body monism. Ism is a belief. Mon means one. In other words, there's only one substance for human beings. What is it? We're all physical. We're material. We have no spirit. All right? That's the Marxist idea. All right. So I went into my class. I said, Professor, can you tell us a little about the author of our textbook? Oh, sure, L.S. Vygotsky. He talked about it. Never mentioned Ivan Pavlov. And I said, well, I understand he was a student of Ivan Pavlov. He said, oh, that's interesting. Why do you point that out? I said, because Ivan Pavlov is now known by historians to have been a hack who used his psychology to help the communists maintain the control over the people. So I'm just curious as to what ideas L.S. Vygotsky took away from Pavlov and what ideas he rejected. Professor said, that is a great question. One of the best questions I've ever heard on this subject. My classmates are all looking at me like, are we supposed to know this? Some of them even discerned out of this I was a Christian. I mean, I 7 people out of the 25 came to me. Are you a Christian? Are you? Don't worry, I won't tell anybody. Why were they so afraid? Because they didn't understand that the Christian worldview is superior. All right, so that's an example of how it works. So here, the last thing, and then we'll be done. In your engagement, take on a posture of curiosity. If I had walked into that class and said, Professor, are you secretly a commie? That would have been the end of my graduate career right there. Just ask questions. Take on a posture of curiosity. Questions like this. Do you think that's the whole story? You think that's the whole story? I had a professor who said, let me sum up all of biblical history for you in one sentence. God is a mean bully. I just raised my hand. I didn't have to challenge him. I said, Professor, are you sure? Is that the whole story? Do you think that's the whole story? He said, what do you mean? I said, you in one sentence summarized 4,000 years of history. You think that's the whole story? I didn't even have to make an argument because the whole class is like, come on, prof, be real here with us. We're smart people. You got to deal with us seriously. Second question, what do you mean? Always ask that. Somebody says there is no God. Don't say yes, there is. Because they'll say no, there's not. And you'll say is so. And they'll say is not. And you'll say is so, you moron. And they'll say is not, you imbecile. 2 Timothy 2:25 and 26, the Lord's servant must not quarrel. All right, so what do you do instead? Just ask, what do you mean by God? One guy said to me, oh, you know, big grandfather figure in the sky who throws lightning bolts down on people he doesn't like. I said, Zeus? I don't believe in Zeus either. Always ask for a definition of the terms. Third question, how did you arrive at that conclusion? This is where people will tell you the truth about their worldview, even though they might have masked it all the way up to this point in time. How did you arrive at that conclusion? Fourth question, how do you know what you believe is true? How do you know? You know, people live as if what they believe is true, even if they say there's no such thing as truth. I've always thought it was ironic with postmodern authors. They would say no words have any meaning, but they would write that. And you're like, so no words have meaning except your words. That's correct. Well, let me tell you what my interpretation of your book is. You're wrong. No, I can't be wrong because every interpretation is right. Just ask the question, how do you know what you believe is true? And the final question, what happens if you're wrong? Boy, if I could steal a couple more minutes from you, I'd tell you a funny story about this. I went to the University of Denver, as I mentioned. The fun thing about being at a school like that is people today on campuses don't want to talk to you, but in those days they did. They would set up booths and tables. So a guy set up a table, it's Animal Rights Day. I said, what are you doing? He said, we're saving baby harp seals. Why are you saving baby harp seals? He said, I don't know, because I guess they're cute, because they're white fuzzy with big black eyes. And sure enough, I looked up a picture of an adult harp seal later. They look like Jabba the Hutt. Nobody wants to save adult grown-up harp seals. But I asked him. I said, so why are you doing this? And he said to me, who are we to say we are any better than any other creature? And I was thinking, that is an opening big enough to drive a truck through. And I like to drive. I said, what about creatures you don't like? He said, well, what do you mean? I said, well, creatures like dust mites. Dust mites float around in the dust. They get in your body. They stay there. They have their babies. They eat your skin cells. They, you know, anyway, they're not that big, by the way, just so you're aware. That picture's expanded. He said, well, why are you bringing this up? I said, well, do you bathe? Yes. He said, I asked, do you use shampoo? Yes. I said, do you know what shampoo does to dust mites? He said, no. I said, it goes inside their little mouths right there, and then they hemorrhage, and they die, and they wash down the drain dead. He said, why should I care? I said, I don't know, but you're the one who said, who are we to say that we are any better than any other creature? How do you justify being a mass murderer of dust mites? You see, and it was just that he laughed, and so we had a really good discussion about ultimate things. And it's incredible how when you take this approach, people just, these days it's awesome. Since I got to Summit, people just were walking up to me. What do you think about this? Lady walked up to me, do you work for Summit? Yeah. She said, I need more God in my life. Like, I've never had that kind of conversation before. But you see, more and more people today are recognizing there is a spiritual component to life. There is something going on that's below the surface, and we have the answer. So, over in the gymnasium, there are a couple things I want you to take a look at. First of all, there's a little flyer that talks about the Summit programs. We want every Christian young person 16 to 21 years of age to come study with us at Summit. And here's something cool. We have one at Biola University, which is just a very short drive from here. June 2016, you'll see the dates right on here, and you can bring students to that. If they say, I live in California, I don't want to go to camp in California, then get them an airplane ticket and send them to Colorado. And we have a program in Tennessee as well. So those programs are all available. You can come pick up those flyers. There are also some books over there. I'm really excited about this. It's called Grow Together. In the Grow Together book, you'll realize there are ways to connect the generations. Do you know that young people who have a mentor in church are three times as likely to stay involved and not walk away from their faith? Which is what maybe one of the biggest problems in the church in the United States of America today. And also we have some copies of the book Understanding the Times there in the gymnasium as well. The table says Summit Ministries. There are two Summit Ministries graduates from our California program who will be there. They can answer your questions. This book is $39.95. It came out on Monday, by the way. You are the first group in the United States of America to see this book. Okay? $39.95. The copies over there are $24.95, so $15. Because we love you, and we want you to, and by the way, if you say, oh, I was planning to spend 40, okay, well, great, then spend a little bit extra, get another copy for somebody you know and love who's going to university this fall, all right? Be sure to do that. I'll just close with this story. I told you about Summit Ministries and our website, summit.org. You'll notice in our building in Colorado, we have a well-lit cross right on the top of the building. Because we are so involved in the community, because we love people, because we challenge them and we walk with them. We have people in our fire department. We're all involved in every aspect of our little community. They think we're crazy for being Christians, but they know we love them. And our cross fell over in a windstorm. A man came up and knocked on the door, and the person said, "Well, what's going on?" He said, "Your cross fell over. You need to get that cross back up there." We know this man is a Buddhist, right? And the staff member said, "Why is it so important to you?" And he said, "Dude, the whole vibe of our town is off when your cross is not on." May that be said of every church in the United States of America. Amen. Thank you so much for your time today.